Hello, everyone. My name is Adrian.
I'm Nick.
And welcome to another episode of Connect. Today, we have Josh Wyatt, the applications manager for our SimpleLink Wi-Fi products. So thanks for joining us, Josh.
Hey, thank you for inviting me, Adrian and Nick. I really appreciate the time you have this afternoon.
Yeah, we're really excited to jump in a lot of topics here, specifically around provisioning. I know there's a lot of unique things that we've done here at TI, but maybe we start off high level. You know, what is provisioning and why should developers care?
Well, Adrian, that's a great question. In the context of Wi-Fi, provisioning is the method by which the device is connected to a network. In Wi-Fi, this is commonly done with an SSID and a password. There's some other fields that can be sent over to assist in that connection, but that's pretty much what it is. Anybody with a smartphone is familiar with this process because they want to keep their data on their cell low, right? So they know that they need to provide an SSID and a password, and then they connect to an access point to get internet access.
Right, right. I guess this is particularly interesting for embedded products because you don't always have a keyboard, you don't always have a touch screen.
That's right, that's okay. Right. Yeah, we call those headless applications. So common ones that we see all the time are doorbells or locks or thermostats, something like that. There is no interface for the user to put in a password or an SSID. So making the provisioning easy for both the application developer and the end user of the product is very important.
Okay. Yeah, now there are several types of provisioning, right? Whether it's a TI home-baked solution or kind of a standard. Can you walk through what different types there are?
Sure. So we have a TI proprietary technology called Smart Config. Basically the access point and the handset and the device are operating in conjunction with each other, sending out messages to one another to accomplish the provisioning. This is not 100% reliable, so we recommend using access point mode, which is over 99% reliable with all the access points that we've ever seen. This is where we turn our SimpleLink Wi-Fi device into an access point. We use a handset. We leverage the handset and the interface on the handset, which has a keyboard and somebody can interact with it, to then connect to the SimpleLink Wi-Fi device, pass those credentials, and then ultimately connect to the access point that's the networked access point that goes to the internet.
Okay. And in this particular instance, I guess the embedded device, the SimpleLink product, is hosting a web server.
That's right. Internally, that's right. It has an internal web server that acts as an access point for that brief period of time. Normally, these devices are stations in the network.
Okay. Yeah, and actually, can you tell us a little bit about that SimpleLink Wi-Fi device, what it is and what kind of advantages it brings maybe to some of these provisioning solutions?
Right. So the SimpleLink Wi-Fi device has what we call a network processor inside of it, and we have a networking subsystem which has all of this provisioning built into it. And what that means is the host can just take the host, meaning the microcontroller, whether that's on a CC3200 or 3220 that has the built-in microcontroller, or a CC3100 or 3120, which is connected to an external host like an MSP432 or any of the CC26XX devices. This is where the host is going to start that process, and then the networking subsystem is going to do all of the steps needed.
Can you then maybe walk us through the process of provisioning, or maybe like a flow chart of how it works?
Sure. So right here on the board, like I said, we start the provisioning process. So the host would kick that off and then block any other commands coming to the SimpleLink Wi-Fi device so it doesn't get interrupted. Because this is a critical point in the life cycle of the product, right?
Yeah.
Once it's installed or being commissioned out in the field. So once the host kicks that off, it's waiting for the configuration. And that configuration can come, as we said before, in access point mode, smart config, that's what the SC stands for, or over another radio technology like BLE or NFC, or the wireless accessory configuration like what is seen in the HomeKit applications. So that's proprietary to those. But once it gets that configuration information, like we said earlier, the SSID and the password, let's say in the most basic form, It would then turn around and connect to the access point of the network that it ultimately would be needing to be connected to. And then it would wait, this whole system would wait for the confirmation back that it was actually connected, right? It's going to test that. And then it would either be connected, or if it fails for some reason, as in like if you're in access point mode and somebody types in the wrong password or the wrong SSID, right? This happens a lot. Yeah. It would fail and go back to waiting for that configuration and then allow the user to keep trying.
Gotcha, gotcha. And then I guess in terms of enabling the developer to have, I guess, as many opportunities for a successful connection, can we enable users to have different forms of provisioning within an application?
Oh yeah, absolutely. So the user or the developer is allowed to mix and match, let's say AP mode and smart config. In fact, if somebody wants to use smart config as their primary method of provisioning, we would recommend to have the backup as AP mode. And then you could always have also BLE or NFC or the WAC operating in conjunction, right? So basically that whole state machine would be running, waiting for the configuration, whether it comes from any of those, it doesn't matter, but it would be waiting for that one. Once it gets one of them, it would then go ahead and complete the process and successfully connect to the network.
Gotcha, cool. Well, I think what I see here is we're providing developers with lots of options. You know, I guess depending on the use case they want to enable for their end user, they've got multiple options, and we're providing, I guess, resources to help them through that.
Absolutely. We certainly do try to provide as many resources as we can through the Symbolink SDK, of course. That's where you get, and the Symbolink Wi-Fi device, that's where you get the AP mode and the smart config, and then for the BLE, NFC, or WAC configuration for provisioning, we offer those in the Symbolink plugins.
Okay. So these are software examples or software extensions on the baseline SDK.
That's right. That's right. That's right. So we have a whole platform that we offer the customers to develop from.
Very cool. Awesome.
Yeah. Makes sense. Thanks. That clears up, especially for me, what kind of provisioning is. Thanks for the overview. Now, if people out there are wanting to go learn more, are there places they can go read about this or delve into more information?
Absolutely. They can go to ti.com/wireless connectivity. They can go to dev.ti.com, and they can also visit the product pages for the CC3200, the CC3220, 3100, or 3120.
Okay, great. Well, thanks again for being here, Josh. This was really helpful. Thank all you guys for joining us. As always, if you want more information about the Symbolink platform, you can visit ti.com/Symbolink. For specifics on the Wi-Fi devices, you can go to ti.com/Wi-Fi. And as always, if you have feedback or questions or you want to suggest some topics for future shows, you can tweet at us at Sensor2Cloud here. Be sure to tune in next week. We've got a very cool hands-on demo with a TI expert, so don't miss out. Thanks, guys.